The 22 forever game is in the books, and man, a lot happened. Cam Rising, Dorian Singer, Brant Keithy, so many more Utes in action, so much to break down, all that and more we're talking about on today's Locked On Utes.
You are Locked On Utes, your daily podcast on the Utah Utes, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for making Locked On Utes your first listen every single day. We are available on all platforms, including YouTube and wherever you may get your podcasts. If this is your first time listening to our show, make sure you like and subscribe. Love interacting with all of you in the YouTube comments as well as on social media, where you can follow our show at Locked On Utes on X. Today's episode of Locked On Utes is brought to you by our friends at LinkedIn Jobs. These days, every new potential hire can feel like a high-stakes wager for your small business. That's why LinkedIn Jobs helps you find the right people for your team faster and for free. Post your job for free at linkedin.com/lockedon. College terms and conditions do apply. My name is JT Wistrcill, former intern inside the University of Utah Athletic Department. Excited to be joined by FanNation's AllUtes, Elijah Grayson Murray, a first-time guest on our show. And speaking of first-timer, I hope you guys all enjoyed our new theme song we had. Shout out to the people at Locked On Utes for mixing it up a little bit. But the biggest thing you guys, of course, are on here for is to hear us talk about the spring game. And man, what a memorable it was, the 22 forever game. It was just great to see this Utah football team back in action. And you know what's really funny, Elijah, is how different the team looked from the fall to the spring. And what's funny is it wasn't a lot of guys leaving. It was just guys getting healthy, watching Cam Rising throw passes, watching Brant Keithy catch them, watching Mekhi Bernard run. And we can get into the Wilsons and the spring game that he had so far. But by far, my biggest takeaway from the game was just seeing Cam back. And I thought he looked really good. And you always take it with a grain of salt when you're talking about a spring game. But I mean, it's hard not to be excited about Cam when he comes out there, goes 15 for 19, throws over 200 yards too, tossed a pair of touchdowns to Money Parks, one of them kind of scrambling as well too, and buying a little bit of time before he made the throw. And then the deep shot too. It was just great to see Utah's leader and number one QB back under center.
Yes, yeah, 100%. You know, for the entirety of spring camp, you know, the players have been saying how amazing it is to have Cam back. And when he's on the field, everyone is trying to play their hardest. You know, he's the undisputed leader of the team. And so to see him kind of play at full speed in front of a crowd, the standing ovation he got when he first stepped on, you know, that's like goosebumps. And, you know, he executed so well. The Money Parks had a great connection with him, and Dorian Singer, you know, coming out the gate, that was really, really great to see.
Yeah, Dorian led the team with 92 receiving yards on 5 catches, and actually could have had a little bit more. That was part, you know, Cam's still shaking off the rest. He even missed him one time too, like that. But one or two misses is kind of natural, even when you are healthy anyways. But man, Singer just looked explosive. You could see right away just his ability to get in and out of his breaks. That change of direction skills are just fantastic. And guy too, hit the defense with a double move, take the top off a little bit too. He just feels poised to be the team's number one receiver. And yes, Brant Keith, he was back there catching passes and making plays. But I mean, it's just hard not to be excited about Singer just after getting a brief taste of what he's capable of doing inside Rice Eccles Stadium, because that Dorian Singer looked a lot more like the one I saw at Arizona back in 2022 than the one who's kind of lost in the shuffle as USC's offense kind of often was this past season. So I'm really excited to see Singer, and I thought this was a great taste of what he can do for the Utah offense.
Yeah, 100%. I'm sticking by my statement that he is probably the most talented target Rising has had in his career at Utah. And that's saying a lot because he had Kincaid. But I think Singer, that connection is going to be so electric. It's the fact that they've had such little time together and they already have this rapport, it's mind-blowing to see with the full offseason, what they could do come the start of the season. I'm super excited. I'm really excited.
Yeah, the fact that they were already throwing even before spring ball had started was something fantastic too. Just developing that early chemistry is something that definitely had me excited too. And you know, I won't go as far and say it's the most talented guy yet, but I'll say this. Because Dalton, I think, was a special tight end. And I think Brant, I'm curious to see the level he'll return to. But even old Brant Keithy was a dude. I do think he will have a better season than even Devon Vele did at his best, just because the speed is a little bit more there in that manner too, like that. But I'm excited to see. I think Singer has a chance to be his best pass catcher, just based on the initial things we've seen. But it's going to be fun to watch it play out. But one of those guys I already just mentioned too is Brant Keithy. Yes, only caught 2 passes. But of course, one of those was a 4th-and-3, right? Like a guy to have. about it type of situation. Another time Cam found him over the middle of the field. And there was just something, it's just something about watching Cam Rising and Brant Keithy connect inside Rice-Eccles Stadium that gets me fired up. And you could see Brant doing a lot of his work too over the middle of the field, where he has been a menace for defenses for a long time inside Rice-Eccles Stadium.
Yeah, 100%. Seeing Keithy and Rising both be able to move how they used to move and come back from injury at pretty much their full capacity. It's really special to see. And, you know, having Keithy run across the middle, it instills a lot of confidence in his ability that he is fully back, which is special. And also it's kind of worrisome for Big 12 opponents, because with you have Keithy, Money Parks, and Singer all on the fire. If you have them firing on all cylinders, it's going to be almost impossible to stop.
It's going to be so challenging too. And I want to talk about a couple of the other guys that came back for Utah in a moment, but just a couple of notes I had while watching Cam. I think the one thing that really stood out to me is just how different the offense is with him under it, especially because too, as we saw Brandon Rose kind of go out there first a little bit like that. And I think Rose still did some positive things, but Cam, just his understanding of the offense, how quick he processes things, is what's going to be the game changer for this Utah offense compared to what they would have if, let's say, Brandon started, or like last year, and a guy in Bryson Barnes and Nate Johnson, right? They were still quarterbacks who did positive things for Utah. But there's a reason that ESPN put out a list and Cam Rising was a top 10 quarterback in it. Cam is a special quarterback, just that ability to quickly diagnose a defense, go like, okay, this guy's open, boom, I'm going to hit him quickly. Also just the natural feel of being able to scramble and things of that nature. I think this offense is going to look so different this fall with Cam Rising under center. And part of that being the weapons that he has at his disposal, like seeing Mekhi Bernard healthy and back in action.
I know. It's, you know, also just the confidence that Cam plays with. We did not see that with any quarterback last year. And so even when he's not on his best game, he's still that confidence is infectious across the team. And either way, they'll play to their best ability. And then Mekhi being back, the running back room is definitely up in the air, like in terms of who would start. And hopefully Mekhi looked really good. He looked really, really good in the game. And I think he has a solid chance to be the number one back heading into the season.
He definitely does. And, you know, Cam's going to be the number one quarterback. I do want to talk about Isaac Wilson in a second, but my biggest takeaway from the game was just seeing Cam out there. And then probably 1A, 1B, it's a Dorian Singer looking as explosive as he did. I'm curious for you, Elijah, having seen it all in person, did you have a takeaway? What was your biggest takeaway from the game?
You know what? I'm right there with you. The connection between, I actually wrote an article yesterday about it, and my number one takeaway from the spring game was the connection between Rising and Singer. Just the numbers that they put up. Obviously, it is a spring game, and so it's not completely full force. But the numbers they put up, it was easy to watch from the beginning that they were on their A game. And that by far and away, my biggest takeaway was their connection.
Yeah, it feels like it's going to be a special one come this fall. And I think we're all excited to see Cam Rising leading this offense.
Yeah.
But it feels like we definitely got our first taste of the future of Utah's offense with what Isaac Wilson did. We have got to talk about his special collegiate debut inside Rice-Eccles Stadium, because, of course, he only won a state championship there his senior year in high school, too, which is crazy because he is just a senior. Want to talk about how crazy that is, that he looked as good as he did in the spring game for still having – I don't even know if he's going to prom yet. We got to dive into all of that in one moment. But first, want to talk to you guys about one of the sponsors of today's episode of Locked On Utes. It's our friends at LinkedIn Talent Solutions. When you're hiring for your small business, you want to find quality professionals that are right for the role. That's why you have to check out LinkedIn Jobs. LinkedIn Jobs has the tools to help you find the right professionals for your team faster and for free. LinkedIn isn't just another job board. LinkedIn helps you the hiring process go by fast and quick, because it just makes it easy and that much faster, because they have over 70% of LinkedIn users who don't visit other leading job sites. So if you're not looking on LinkedIn, you're looking in the wrong place, basically. On LinkedIn, 86% of small businesses get a qualified candidate within 24 hours. Hire professionals like a professional on LinkedIn. LinkedIn knows that small businesses are wearing so many hats, they might not have the time or resources to hire. LinkedIn is constantly finding ways to make that process easier. And they even just launched a feature that helps you write a job description, making the process that much quicker. 2.5 million small businesses use LinkedIn for hiring. Post your job for free at linkedin.com/lockedoncollege. That's linkedin.com/lockedoncollege. College to post your job for free. Terms and conditions do apply. Also want to tell you guys about something exciting we have going on here at the Locked On Network coming up. It's Locked On NFL Mock Draft Live on April 17th at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, streaming on the Locked On Sports Today 24/7 streaming channel on YouTube or the free Amazon Fire TV channel app. Find the ultimate six-episode series on April 17th, once again, at 7 p.m. ET, to hear what the local Locked On experts are picking for every NFL franchise, with live reactions from local college football experts, even the fantasy football angle. Locked On NFL Mock Draft on April 17th at 7 ET, streaming live on local Locked On Sports 24/7 streaming channel on YouTube or for free on the Amazon Fire TV channel. Elijah, we talked about that. Look, Cam, because he's Cam Rising and had over 200 yards passing, he stole the day. I'll say this, I was very encouraged by how much Cam we saw. I was a little worried this would be like 2 years ago in the spring game when it was Devon Bailey's kind of breakout spring. I think they gave Cam like one drive. I just love that we got to see so much out of Cam. But the other guy we got to see a ton out of too is Isaac Wilson. And man, did he impress. Just had a number of throws where you're like, whoa. I mean, he went 8 for 12 for 165 yards and 2 touchdowns. He hit one of them, hit for Caldara, the other one on Landon King too. And I was so impressed, not just with his poise, but just the zip on the ball. I mean, my gosh, it comes out of his hands so fast. I mean, even Yogi Roth, who called the spring game yesterday, I thought he made a great point talking about how Wilson did a good job holding the defense to one side with his eyes to get Landon King open. And he said, that's just not the type of play you usually see from a freshman. It's early in his career. And it's so early in his career, I'll go back to, he's still a senior. He's going to graduate coming up here shortly. But I just can't, I don't think I can illustrate better. I was just so impressed with Wilson, and I really do now believe all the hype about whether it was Kyle Whittingham at first, like trying to push Rose. I think this is a legit competition, and I think Wilson seriously has a chance to win it. And he looked like the more impressive quarterback to me on Saturday.
Yeah, 100%. The entirety of spring camp, Whittingham has been saying that the QB2 battle is a dead heat, and the spring game was really a marker for who would come out on top, I think. And Wilson just blew me away. I don't think any of us expected to see that much of him. But I think we're all glad that we did, because he dazzled we were talking in the press box, and we were just all absolutely in shock at how well Wilson did compared to Rose. And I think that gives him a massive boost. And like you said, I do think he has a legitimate chance to win the QB2 job now.
Yeah, I mean, his size wasn't an issue in the game. Just did a great job hitting Caldara on the double move. Like, there were a couple balls throughout the game. Cam had one, the deep one to Dorian, the one to Caldara too. Like, they were slightly underthrown, but it's like, okay, at least he hit him, and it wasn't egregiously underthrown, at least for the collegiate level type of throws too. So just so impressed with Wilson's ability throughout the game like that, just to find his open guys and make those decisions too. And I think one thing that was also encouraging is to see how well he was clicking with Landon King. King is a guy that, look, we know Utah had Carson Ryan, obviously get Brant Keithy back, but it's pretty easy to see that King is going to have to be on the field most, if not all, of the third downs. His athleticism at the tight end position is a complete mismatch. His ability to adjust to passes, I think, is phenomenal. So he's a guy I'm really excited and fired up to see. And I mean, now we've talked about King, we already talked about Keithy. We also saw some other guys, right? Money Parks had a couple of monster grabs in this game. Dorian Singer doing what he did too. Micah Pittman adding a few catches in here too. This feels like it could be the most talented overall group of pass catchers that Cam Rising or whoever is starting at quarterback, barring, of course, Cam Rising injury, we would have at his disposal.
100%. I mean, the duo at tight end of Keithy and Landon King, you know, you have Keithy, who obviously already has the connection with Cam. And then you have King, who's just, like you said, an athletic specimen. He's so big. And the fact that you can compare his height and his size with his athleticism, he's a nightmare on third down. And then obviously with Micah Pittman getting into his groove, Money Parks still doing his thing and taking advantage of his speed, and Singer coming in, bringing his experience and forming the connection with Cam, like we said, I don't see how it isn't the most talented group that Cam has had. And if he does, let's hope he does not, but in the terrible circumstance that he does get injured, whoever comes in after him should benefit from having such a talented group.
Yeah, I definitely think they will. And, you know, Cam did great. Wilson did great. Rose did not do great, but I also want to defend Rose a little bit. He was 70 yards, 8 of 11 passing overall, too. I did not think the offensive line did Rose a lot of favors. I felt like he was under duress a lot. I didn't see as much separation there, too. Now, I will also say, like, he did, there were missed throws. There were times I was like, okay, boom, pressure in your face. Like, I know this is a spring game, and maybe they told, this is where it's hard, right? Did they tell him to hold on to the ball? Right. But I'm just like, okay, if you see this guy coming, I would rather you just throw it to your running back really quick. Just take the check down there, because I can see. It wasn't, I don't think it was Vincent. I can't remember who the back is now that he had at his disposal on a couple occasions, but there was just a few times there too. But things I liked out of Rose, I thought he showed good speed when escaping the pocket. And we know what a big part that was for Bryson's game last year when he came in and had to be the starter for most of the year. So I thought that was nice to show the ability to scramble too, and still made some strong throws too. And it's going to be really interesting to see like who does win this backup job, because I still think Rose, having the experience that he has, nearly winning it last year. And we already saw from the 23 spring game, Rose was the better quarterback in that. But then even before the injury, Bryson was trending towards starting. Wilson looked like the better quarterback yesterday, but would Kyle Whittingham thrust a true freshman out there when you have a guy in Rose who knows the system better just because he's been in it longer and will probably take a little bit better care of the ball? That's what I'm fascinated to see, Elijah.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, throughout spring camp, Rose has really impressed me with his mobility and his zip that he has. I was hoping that he would be able to show it more during the spring game, but like you said, he was under a lot of pressure, and maybe Coach Whittingham didn't want him to just check it down and show his ability to run more. But I do think, despite the fact that Wilson was had such an incredible performance, the experience that Rose has, and he's a big quarterback, right? He's not short in stature or anything. And so I think Rose still has the edge just in terms of his experience, but it does make me wonder, because he didn't do so well in the spring game, if they will go after a transfer quarterback.
It's definitely a possibility. It's something Kyle Whittingham didn't rule out, and it would be interesting to see. It's going to be hard to land a guy who's just like, oh, yeah, I'm content being a backup, I think. Right. But you're right. It's definitely something that's on the table, and be interesting to see. We'll definitely talk about later on this week's Locked On Utes, too, how they kind of view the backup quarterback spot after the spring game, because that could be something the team looks to do. So we talked a lot about the passing offense. Let's talk about the running game a little bit. It was awesome to see Jalen Glover out there, had added 20 rushing yards and a touchdown too. And he was involved in the passing game too. I thought Glover he continues to look more experienced. Mm-hmm. I thought he was reading his blocks well. I think he looked a little more explosive as well too. I'll say nice to see him involved in the passing game. Already talked about Makai a little bit. Just see that speed back. There was one, like, I think it was like a 10 to 15 yard run he had. Maybe it was a little less than that even, but it's good to see him back and be explosive. And even a guy like a Mike Mitchell, I mean, he just looked big, and you can see why the team is very high on him too. You said it yourself. The running back room is very much up in the air, but I was encouraged by what we saw from all the guys. And I didn't even mention a guy like DeJon Stanley, John Randall, too. Charlie Vincent also popped a little bit, too. Right. So lots of capable bodies in the Utah running back room.
100%. And Mitchell's throughout camp, Mitchell has been one that's really stood out to me. He's been used in a lot of different scenarios, and he's been hitting the gaps really well. I think if I were to pick the running back room right now, I think a 1-2 punch of Bernard and Glover would cover all areas of the backfield. You know, you have the passing game with Glover, and more power running, and then speed game, you have Bernard, and then maybe in goal line situations, you put in Mitchell. But there's so much versatility among all the guys, and they all have their special skill sets that can actually contribute to winning a game. And then also we have Anthony Woods that still has to come in. And so that's another a wrench in the plan. But I definitely think that this running back room, while there's not like one standout starter, all of them can combine to be really effective.
Yeah, and the offensive line I also thought looked pretty good. I liked Caleb Lomu. I thought did a pretty good job too. There was one of the I think it was one of the deep balls, or maybe it was one of the underthrown ones that Cam had, or it was a miss. I can't remember exactly, but I do remember there was one time that Lomu got drove back a little bit, but I think that was against Connor O'Toole, who I do expect to be a pretty good pass rusher this coming season too. That wasn't too much of a negative. Fauna looked good at the right tackle spot. I was overall impressed with Utah's offensive line in the game. Talk about just some other things that stood out. And it was defensively, it's hard because, man, a lot of guys were sitting out. I mentioned in a short video yesterday, thought Cameron Calhoun looked really good. He did a number of nice things throughout the game too, actually. Finish overall with six tackles and a pass breakup too. Speaking of pass breakups, Nate Richie's earlier in the game, that deep shot that Rose kind of took, seeing Richie fly over and knock that away, just kind of proved his experience. And that Nate Richie we saw in 2020, which feels like forever ago, he's getting back up to speed and pace. So I'm excited to see him as well too. And I mean, I think the only final thought I'd add is, I saw, because there was a comment about, like, are we concerned about Utah's passing defense giving up some yards? Not a ton, because of how many guys didn't play. And the other thing I'll say is this. A lot of what was given up was over the middle of the field, where Kerenne Reed, Lander Barton, and, like, those guys will share that up. There's no DeMooney. That will be the one thing. I'll talk about this more on this week. I would not be surprised to see Utah go in the portal and look for a third running back. I think, third linebacker, because I think there's other guys. Like, Sione Fotu is solid there too, but I think if there's no one of the caliber that DeMooney was at that third spot. So I'm curious to see them go and get that. But with so many guys for the Utah defense not in action, I'm not going to be like, oh, I'm concerned. And also, they gave up 200 yards to Cam Rising. There's a lot of defenses that can stand up and say that throughout the country.
Yeah, for sure. I think our cornerback unit is really, really special. You have the two transfers, the Keenan Johnson and Cam Calhoun. You know, they bring a lot of experience. Keenan Johnson has had an incredible camp, and Cam Calhoun obviously had an incredible spring game performance. I think those two, with Teo Johnson, you know, really settling into a safety spot. I agree with you. I do think they should probably go fishing in the portal for a third linebacker to shore up the middle. But I think other than that, the line looked really good. And the secondary, obviously there was a lot of guys sitting out, but when fully healthy and then, you know, when you have everyone on the same page, it'll be hard to get a passing game going, at least on the wide parts of the field.
It is going to be tough for defenses to do it. I really believe. So I'm excited to see what they can do. And we got to talk about what all the excitement around the spring game means as it pertains to when we finally see this team on the field in the fall. We're going to be diving into that in one moment. But first, I want to talk to you all about one of the sponsors of our episode of Locked On Utes, our friends at FanDuel. It's playoff time in the NBA, NHL. Baseball is in full swing too, and FanDuel is your place to bet on every game. Right now, new customers can get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed. That's $150, win or lose, bet on everything from slap shots to home runs to slam dunks, all in an app that's safe, secure, and easy to use. What are you waiting for? Visit FanDuel.com/lockedon and make your first bet an automatic win. That's capital L for locked and a capital O and on, but locked on, one word, no spaces. And once again, make that first bet an automatic win. And speaking of FanDuel, I'm excited for the play-in games this week. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. You know, we're gonna have star power in these playing games, right? Whether it's the Warriors, the Lakers are supposed to be in it too at the time we're recording this. Like, there is going to be a lot of fun matchups to see how it turns out in the NBA. Unfortunately, the Jazz aren't going to be in there, sorry guys, but still a lot of fun action to watch happen throughout the playoffs. So make sure you guys head over to FanDuel, America's number one sports book. All right, Elijah, closing this one out. First, I did want to ask you, was there any plays or any players that we had not mentioned yet that you think deserves some love before we get out of here on this 22 Forever game post-pod recap?
Dang, that's a tough one. I think Cam Calhoun is just really one of the guys that I did not expect to make such a big impact in the game. He's been relatively quiet during the practices. So I think he really showed what he can provide to the team this spring game and for the upcoming year. And I think that is a more underrated signing for the transfer portal that we had.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I think he's a guy who has a chance to do some nice things. It's going to be hard because this Utah defensive backfield has a lot of capable guys. Who's going to beat who out? That's what's going to be really exciting to see come fall camp, as a lot of these battles will continue to go on. And I will mention one just funny thing about the spring game. We are now over 23 minutes into this pod, and I just realized I didn't mention who won the game, which was the red team. They won 41-21, but that's just the truth of these things. The final score doesn't matter. It's how you feel and how you're encouraged by everything. Also, part of the reason the we saw the red team do so much work, right, is because of Cam Rising. So actually, in part, it does play a part in one of the reasons because of how Cam put up points. I mean, the red team got out to what, like a 21-0 lead, was it, Elijah?
Yeah, it was a pretty big gap to start.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, say they won by 20. So it was a crazy game in terms of some of the scoring and the weird things that play out like that for a spring game, but a huge successful day for Utah, and not even just because of how encouraged we have to feel by all of the units on the field, I feel like, but I'll also say, because even some of the backups throughout the game, like there was a DN who would get pressure, and I'm like, who is that? And I'm like, I wasn't as familiar with this guy because he's like the fourth or fifth DN, actually not even the fourth, my gosh, he's probably the third or fourth string DN. Like literally there's like five or six DNs in front of him. And then I looked up and saw his name. So we didn't get to see everyone in action, but I'm incredibly encouraged by everything we saw too. I think the other thing I love about the 22 Forever game, of course, is all the proceeds and benefit going to the Memorial Fund for Aaron Lowe and Ty Jordan too. It's such a great thing the university does to continue to keep the memories and legacies of those players alive. So a really successful day for Utah football on and off the field. It was super fun to get to watch it play out. And I know Elijah, you got to cover it too. So truly just something exceptional. And speaking of you getting to cover it, Elijah, if people want to check out more of your work, where should they head over to?
Yeah, so I write for FanNation AllUtes, so you can go there and check out my articles. And then I also post all my articles on Twitter, which or X, which you can find right under my my camera at Elijah G. Murray is my Twitter.
Elijah, great stuff. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you so much. It was fun.
That's going to do it for today's edition of Locked On Utes, but we're not even close to talking about the spring game, and we got other things to talk about outside of the game. The transfer portal, not just for football, but also for basketball, which is starting to pick up some steam. Utah Gymnastics has a big week ahead. There's still a lot going on, even though we're getting into the middle of April on Locked On Utes, so make sure you guys stick with us if you want to hear more about your team every day.